video, you're going to be learning all about the central processing unit, otherwise known as the CPU. Now, if we have a look at a motherboard, here's one that I took out of a laptop, then there's certain areas you need to be aware of. We have the ROM and the RAM, which you're going to be learning about in another video. And here we have the CPU chip itself. Now, normally when you see images of a CPU chip in textbooks, it's actually upside down. This is the underside of the CPU, which has the pins on it, which connect onto the motherboard. Let's just have a look at the motherboard in more detail. Here we can see a zoom in between the ROM and the CPU, and there is a connection between them called a bus. A bus carries data around the motherboard on very thin wires. There's also a bus between the RAM and the CPU to carry the messages there. If we have a look at a micro bit, you can see that the CPU is much smaller and it's even been labelled for you. Now let's have a look at a zoom in of the CPU chip to see what's happening inside. Each of those tiny lines with the dots at the end is a transistor. And a transistor is minute. In fact, there are 80,000 times thinner than a human hair. Now that's really difficult to comprehend. Now there is something called Moore's law, which states that every 2 years, the amount of transistors normally doubles. And so therefore the processing power also will be doubling every 2 years. Now, what that actually means is the transistors act like little switches that end in logic gates. And so the data can be carried along and can be manipulated using these tiny transistors. However, that does generate an awful lot of heat. Here we are looking at the inside of a desktop computer. And this large metal object is a heat sink. What that does is it conducts the heat away from the CPU, which is sitting underneath it. So let's remove it and have a look at the CPU itself. Now, it's not a good idea to remove the heatsink in your own computers because there's a paste that combines the two together and allows the heat to conduct efficiently away from it. But here you can see the CPU is located on the main motherboard. Once the heatsink has removed a lot of the heat, then a fan at the computer will blow it out into the air, which is why sometimes you find computer rooms get very hot very quickly and they often need air conditioning to cool them down. Now, also on the motherboard is something called cache memory. Now, often this is built into the CPU chip itself. However, it might be another chip that's separate on the motherboard, but it'd be very close to the CPU. The reason we have cache memory is it stores the most frequent instructions that it's likely to use, and it saves time from having to go and get them from RAM or even secondary memory. Now, the way that a CPU works, it uses the fetch-execute cycle, but really, there's three stages. It fetches, decodes, and executes it. So it should be called the fetch, decode, execute cycle. The first part is fetching the instruction from the cache memory. Now, this uses a program counter to keep track of which instruction it needs to go and get next. Once it's fetched the instruction, then it needs to decode it and make sense of what it's trying to tell it to do. So it'll transfer it into machine code or binary. Once it's decoded the message, then it can execute it. And that could be something like go and fetch information from the memory, go and store information in the memory, or perform some sort of calculation. And once it's done that, then it starts the whole cycle again. And it'll do this billions of times a second. So that's how a CPU works.